Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present As Good As Gone by Larry Watson. Narrated by Richard Poe. Chapter 1. He's watching, Bill Sidey thinks. My father is watching me at this very moment. But Bill can't take his eyes off the road, a steep, twisting, two-track trail that winds down from the top of the butte to the canyon floor. A juniper bush scratches the side of the car, and Bill winces. Something that sounds more solid than weeds scrapes along the undercarriage. But there's nothing Bill can do other than keep the tires in the ruts and feather the brakes to make sure he doesn't lose control on his descent. And sure enough, when the road finally levels off and Bill permits himself to look farther ahead, he sees the figure that he's sure has been there all along. A tall, lean, white-haired man stands in the open doorway of a 20-foot house trailer, his hands jammed in the pockets of his faded Levi's. Calvin Sidey, Bill's father. A hawk with prey in sight, could not watch more intently. Bill parks next to the familiar old Ford truck, yet his father makes no move to come forward. Bill climbs out of the car, and when he slams the door behind him, it sets up an echo that bounces from one canyon wall to the other. He lives here, Bill thinks, so he can see the enemy approach. It's the same thought he's had on other occasions when he's driven out to his father's home. But this time Bill wonders if even he has that status in his father's eyes. His father calls out warily,
"I didn't know you were coming."
To that, Bill has no response. His father doesn't have a telephone. He picks up his mail no more than once or twice a week. How can anyone, son or stranger, notify Calvin Sidey of an impending visit? His father tries again.
"What brings you out this way?"
And that's Calvin Sidey in a sentence. Let's get to it. Well, that suits Bill, too. When he looks toward his father, Bill has to shield his eyes against the sun glinting off the trailer's aluminum siding. "I've got a favor to ask." His father steps back inside the trailer. But since he doesn't shut and lock the door behind him, Bill understands that he's supposed to follow. The trailer's interior, even with windows open on every side, must be 15 degrees hotter than the July afternoon that's already topped 90 degrees.
"Can I get you a cup of coffee?"
his father asks. "Coffee? Jesus, no. A glass of water, please?" The trailer is exactly as Bill remembers it, and why not? It's likely that nothing more than the calendar page has changed since Bill was last here, though he can't recall when that might have been. His father has his life stripped down to the essentials, and for everything that's left, he has a hook, shelf, bin, drawer, peg, or rack. Bill guesses that in the cupboard there are no more than one, or at most two, plates, bowls, glasses, and cups. In that same cupboard will be a can of coffee, a box of oatmeal, a few cans of soup and beans, lard, crackers, flour, sugar, salt, and pepper. Above the two-burner stove hang a saucepan and a frying pan. On a shelf above the neatly made bed is a short row of books, and though Bill can't see the titles, he doesn't have to. These are his father's copies of Virgil, Horace, Juvenal, Ovid, Cicero, Catullus, and Pliny. The homemade gun rack above the door holds his Winchester lever-action 30-30, a 12-gauge Remington pump shotgun, and a fishing pole. And there's that calendar, hanging right next to the door. It's this year's, and the page is turned to the correct month, but Bill wonders if his father knows the date. Even if he does, the day surely doesn't mean holiday to him the way it does for most Americans. Though it's hard to imagine a man who values independence more than Calvin Sidey. Bill stands by the small kitchen table, but since his father has not invited him to sit down, Bill doesn't pull out one of the two chairs. And why two, Bill wonders, since his father lives alone and never has guests. From a pitcher on the counter, Calvin Sidey pours water into a glass, then sets the glass on the table next to an open book. Bill can't decipher any of the words on the page because the book is in Latin, a subject Bill never studied in school, but which his father has never stopped studying and translating. Also on the table is an ashtray containing a few butts of hand-rolled cigarettes. Bill brings the glass to his lips and drinks. The water isn't very cold, and it has a brassy odor. Why don't you move this trailer, Dad? That stand of cottonwoods can't be more than 50 yards away, and if you were parked over there, you'd have some shade. His father crosses his arms.
You said you had a favor to ask.
Bill is sweating in these close quarters, and he loosens his tie and collar. Marjorie needs an operation.
Uh-huh.
She has to have a hysterectomy. It's an operation to...
I know what a hysterectomy is. What I don't know is why you felt you had to come out here and tell me about it in person. How serious is this?
She has... not tumors, exactly, but growths. Painful growths.
All right, his father says. I'm sorry to hear this. But you drove all the way out here. What's the favor you need?
Do you mind if I sit down? Bill asks, then pulls out a chair before his father can answer.
There's an odor in the trailer that Bill can't quite place, a smell reminiscent of gasoline or fresh paint. He looks around to see if his father has recently painted or varnished something. Then it comes to him. Kerosene. Lacking electricity, his father relies on candles or kerosene lamps. It's 1963, but in many ways his father is living in the 19th century. Of course it's stifling inside the trailer, Bill thinks. His father doesn't even have a fan to stir the heat or a refrigerator to keep food cold. And not far from the trailer is an outhouse.
There's a doctor in Missoula who'll perform the operation, Bill says. Carol, you remember Marjorie's sister? Had the same condition as Marjorie. Same symptoms, same tests. Apparently it's something that runs in the family. And Carol had the surgery. Before then, she'd tried everything. And she says if it wasn't for the operation, she'd still be suffering.
Most women would just bite down hard and wait for the misery to pass, which it will.
Most women?
In my experience.
Something of an expert, are you, Dad? His father ignores this question.
Marjorie has to go to Missoula. I know Gladstone's got doctors who can perform a hysterectomy.
Bill has to smile. His father is still loyal to Gladstone, though he turned his back on the town almost 30 years ago.
Well, how about Mitch McCoy? His father says. Last I heard, he was still practicing.
The last you heard? When was that? Dr. McCoy is in a nursing home in Miles City.
Mitchell McCoy? Are you sure?
The heat, the long drive, his father's questions, Bill Sidey suddenly feels tired. He leans on his hand and rubs his eyes. Yeah, Dad, I'm sure. Look, I can't pretend to explain it very well. Apparently, the Missoula doctor has a special procedure. He doesn't take out the entire womb or something. The point is, Marjorie wants the operation. She needs the operation.
And I reckon you're all set for her to have what she needs.
We're leaving in a few days.
Uh-huh.
Bill inhales deeply and then exhales, but the heat seems to prevent his breath from traveling far.
That's what I wanted to ask you about, Dad. Would you be willing to stay with the kids while Marjorie and I are in Missoula?
His father involuntarily takes a step backward.
Have you spoken to your sister about this?
Jeanette and I have sort of lost touch. I assume she's still in New Hampshire. We send the Christmas and birthday cards there, and they don't come back undeliverable. Of course, we don't get any acknowledgement from her either. How about you? Bill asks, though he's certain of the answer. Do you hear from her? His father gives a quick shake of his head.
What I'm asking you for, says Bill, wouldn't be more than a week, at most. You're traveling in a few days, you say.
He's trying to find a way to say no, Bill thinks. He's out of practice, and he can't find a reason quick enough. Why doesn't he come right out and say it? They're not my kids or my responsibility.
He could say it when the children were his own, so what's stopping him now?
Suddenly, Bill, who all his life has felt diminished in this man's presence, feels an odd surge of power. Anne and Will, says Bill,
in case you're trying to recall their names. Anne's 17 and Will's 11.
I know my grandchildren's names.
Anne's working at JCPenney this summer, Bill continues. That's why I'm asking you for this favor. Ordinarily, Anne could take care of her brother and take care of the house. But with the hours she's working, Will would be alone too much of the day. From out of his shirt pocket, his father takes a packet of cigarette papers. And when he looks around for his tin of Sir Walter Raleigh, Bill hurries to offer his father one of his own camels. The men light their cigarettes, and while this action has given his father an extra minute to think, it's less time than he would have had rolling his own. Have you been working, Dad? There, Bill thinks. He's opened a door through which his father can escape. He can simply excuse himself by saying he has the obligations of a job.
Not since last fall, his father says. I helped George Tell move his herd down from summer pasture. I'm sure he moved them back up last month, but I didn't hear from him. Before that, I don't recall.
We could hire a babysitter, Bill says. A college girl home for the summer, perhaps. Though that might embarrass Anne, someone there so close to her age. Or maybe we could find a farm girl. But you know the house, Dad, and the business, and you're... Bill isn't sure why he suddenly stops short of uttering the word, especially since it's the word that he came here to say to his father.
I'm what?
Family, says Bill, relieved that the word didn't snag on the way out. His father draws deep on the camel, lets the smoke drift from his nostrils, then examines the cigarette as if he's never smoked a tailor-made before.
When did you say you're leaving?
He says. Sunday, right after church. And, Dad, I'm not asking you to do anything with the kids. Just to be there, just in case. His father walks to the trailer door, opens it, and flicks his cigarette outside.
I'll be there Saturday, he says.
His father remains in the doorway, his hand on the handle of the screen door. Just as Bill understood earlier that he was supposed to follow his father inside the trailer, now he understands that he's expected to leave. I'll look for you then, Bill says. He steps out into the shadowless sunlight, and though the air is not moving outside the trailer any more than it was inside, it's the rare, calm day in this part of Montana. Bill feels as though his first breath outdoors goes right to the bottom of his lungs.
And Bill, his father calls after him. Don't put anyone out of their room. I'll fix up a little space in the basement.
The basement? Dad...
It'll be cooler down there.
Cooler? Bill thinks but doesn't say. Yet you live here.
And it'll give me some privacy,
his father adds. Privacy for what? Bill thinks.
Whatever you say, Dad. I'll see you Saturday.
From inside the trailer, Calvin watches his son drive away. He wonders why he said yes to his son's request, which, he can't help noting, was offered without a please and accepted without a thank you. Hadn't he banished long ago any feelings of obligation to others? Did he say yes simply because of blood? Could he have said no to anyone but his son? Or is this solitary life less endurable than he believes? Maybe he would have listened to any request that tried to bring him back inside the human circle.
Well, no point in speculating. He had said yes.
The car is out of sight now, but he can hear it, the engine laboring hard as it tries to crest the butte.
Shift down, goddammit,
Calvin thinks, though Bill has climbed plenty of hills without his father's help. Calvin walks back to the table. He stands over the book he'd been reading earlier. He flips pages until he comes to a poem he knows well. The words are in Latin, but in English he recites softly.
Now he is treading that dark road to the place from which they say no one has ever returned.
Calvin has to smile to himself.
Such portentous lines for a bird.
Chapter 2 There, right behind those rocks just breaking the river's surface. At the spot where the water swirls and seems to back up on itself, Bill keeps casting. He knows there's deep water there, cool depths that walleye, pike, and bass prefer in this weather. He's thrown spoons, spinners, poppers, jigs, and damn near everything else in his tackle box into this section of the Elk River. But he hasn't had a hit yet. Not that he minds. He's merely killing time, putting off that inevitable moment when he has to return home and tell his wife about the trip he's taken today. He recalls something that Beverly Lodge once said. Men, once they have an excuse to go, they're liable to stay gone. He didn't think a remark applied to him, but maybe he's no different from other men who are in no hurry to go home at the end of the day. The men who would rather stop for a drink or two at the Elks Club or the VFW rather than go see their wives and children. Bill reels in his line. The current's tugged strong enough that he can almost believe he has a fish on the other end. No such luck. Well, he's fished the hell out of this stretch of the river. He walks perhaps a quarter of a mile upstream, the setting sun throwing his shadow far ahead until it vanishes in the darkening tall grass. He heads for a grove of cottonwoods not far away, a spot on the river he knows well, and not only because he's fished these waters so often over the years. There, the river swings wide and slow. 20 years ago, Bill thought he might lose his life there. That was the summer of 1943, when he and Sleepy Bryant and Chuck McMahon were told they were likely to ship out before the month was out. In the meantime, they fished the Elk River at every opportunity. On that particular day, they had driven farther from Gladstone than usual, out to a stretch of river where they'd heard fish were biting. They parked their car near a narrow, rickety wooden bridge, and they worked their way downriver to this shady grove. They'd also worked their way through the better part of a case of beer, and by late afternoon, Bill left the fishing to his friends and lay down under a cottonwood for a nap. He woke to the sound of two words, "Don't move." And Bill's first thought was that a rattlesnake was nearby, and he made sure he moved nothing but his eyes, which revealed to him a figure aiming a pump-action .22 at him. The rifle was in the hands of a teenager, maybe 14 or 15, and tall and sunburned. The hair curling out from his battered straw hat was so blonde it was almost white, and the hat was pulled low and cast his eyes entirely in shadow. Over his shoulder, he called out to someone Bill couldn't see. "Hey, if I shoot this one here, we can bury him on the spot." Another voice, deeper and more serious, answered, "Bury him? What in hell for?" The voice attached itself to another tall blonde in a straw hat. He was older than the man pointing the rifle at Bill, and there wasn't much doubt they were brothers. The most important similarity, however, was that he too was armed. His carbine was pointed at Sleepy and Chuck, marching up from the riverbank with their hands raised over their heads. The younger man asked his brother, "Should I have this one here stick his hands up too?" "He's laying down, for Christ's sake. He don't need his hands up." "Was this land posted or something?" Sleepy asked. "We didn't see any signs. We parked up by the road and hiked down here."
"We know where you parked your goddamn car," the older brother said. "And you don't fish around here without we say so."
"You don't own this river," Chuck said.
Sleepy's tone had been conciliatory, but Chuck could barely contain his anger.
"We don't need your permission to fish here." "Then how come you got your hands in the air like a scared son of a bitch?"
That remark brought a giggle from the younger brother. For some reason, his good humor was especially frightening. The older brother's surly attitude seemed more in keeping with the situation. The younger one's laughter was the behavior of someone whose next action could not be predicted. Still lying flat in the cottonwood shade, Bill asked,
"Either of you fellas work with a /9? "What the hell's it to you?"
the older brother asked.
"I know this is /9 country,"
Bill answered, in a voice far too cheerful to belong to a man with a gun pointed at him.
"And I thought you boys might be with their outfit." "We don't work for nobody,"
the younger man said hesitantly.
"Just thought I'd ask," Bill said. "My old man rides with a /9. You know him? Cal Sidey?"
Never heard of him,
the older man said, but it didn't matter. Bill's willingness to name himself had made him impossible to kill. The brothers spat out a few more threats.
Don't ever wet a line along this stretch of river or you'll find yourself face down in the water. Any fish you caught, leave them on a stringer. They're ours now.
But their venom had lost its potency, and they soon sent Bill and his friends on their way. Later, back in Gladstone, after Bill, Chuck, and Sleepy told others about their run-in, they learned about the Hanlon brothers, owners of a small ranch that shared some fence line with a slash nine. The Hanlons had a reputation not only for being maniacally territorial, but also for black-hearted meanness. Rumor had it they had once cut the balls off an Indian and left him in a ditch, possibly to bleed to death. Chuck swore that he would return to that span of the river and have his revenge on the brothers. Maybe on his first furlough, he'd load up a truck with Gladstone's toughest men, and they'd give the Hanlons the beatings they deserved. Chuck McMahon was not inclined to bluster or boast. That he never followed through on his vow had nothing to do with a lack of courage or resolve, and everything to do with the fact that he left most of his right leg on an island in the South Pacific. Bill never knew for certain if the mention of his father's name had anything to do with extricating him and his friends from their difficult situation. The Slash Nine was a huge outfit, and Bill's father was just one more hired hand. Exactly what he had been since the day he left Bill and his sister when they were children. But Bill had invoked the Sidey name, and because he did, he has often wondered, did he save himself, or was it the father who saved the son? For that matter, back at his father's trailer, was the son asking the father for help, or was the son trying to help the father? The sun has set, and darkness is leaping forth from inside the grove of cottonwoods and the thickets of sagebrush, snowberry, and chokecherry. Nighthawks are swooping invisibly overhead, their presence revealed only by their pink, pink calls. The river itself still shines, its surface somehow able to find light that has all but vanished from the sky. Bill reels in his line again, this time for good. He hooks the lure through the rod guide and begins the long walk back to his car. Why doesn't his father make his home in a spot like this, near fresh water, shade, and shelter from the wind? With heavier woods right over there, with a supply of blown-down and deadfall trees and limbs that would offer winter fuel. This is a site that Bill would choose, and solitude aplenty, if that's what a man wants. But this is just one more useless observation about the difference between him and his father. If he keeps driving, he can pull into his driveway in no more than 10 minutes. Nevertheless, Bill decides to pull off the road on top of one of the bluffs that overhang the city of Gladstone. He climbs out of the car and walks closer to the edge of the butte, accidentally kicking an empty beer can. He's sure there are more in the vicinity. He lights a cigarette. From this height, Bill can see the confluences, the Elk River, Willow Creek, the Northern Pacific Railroad line, and mile after mile of rolling grassland that led to the formation of a community down there in the first place. And in the middle of the panorama is the city itself, with its glowing, winking lights. He has a perfect view of the lights that this year spangle the night sky over Gladstone for the second time inside of 3 weeks. The exploding rockets, starbursts, and fountains leave a much different impression when a man looks down rather than up at them. You'd think they'd look puny with the vastness of the night sky as backdrop, but the opposite is true. It's all the land surrounding this exhibition that makes it seem small and a little sad. Perhaps this is why no other spectators are parked up here tonight. The display won't last long. Gladstone celebrated its 75th anniversary on June 16th. And last winter, the Rotary Club voted in favor of an unequal division of the annual budget for fireworks. 70% for the town's birthday and 30% for today, July 4th, 1963. There, that probably represents the grand finale. The cottony booms that reach him after those flashes are the loudest so far. And nothing else has reached as high, glowed as brightly, or lingered as long as those red, white, and blue sparks.
His wife and son and daughter are down there someplace, perhaps close enough to smell the black powder and trace the pattern of smoke in the aftermath of each explosion. And though Bill knows he belongs with them, he still cannot make himself move. The car's cooling engine ticks impatiently. The stars recapture the night sky, but Bill remains on the top of the hill. As soon as he returns home, he'll have to tell his family that Calvin is coming for a visit. Chapter 3. In order to see the back of the refrigerator, Bill pushes aside the wedge of watermelon, the bowl of creamed cucumbers, the tinfoil-covered tub of potato salad, and the half-eaten ham. All items are returned to the racks only moments before. "I could have sworn I had another beer in here," he says. "One isn't enough?" Marjorie asks. She knows her husband's habits well. Bill drinks infrequently and seldom more than a single beer. "I spent part of the day in Calvin Sidey's company," Bill says, "in his oven of a home, so no, one's not enough." He means the remark as a joke, but it elicits no laughter. He gives up on the idea of a second beer and returns to his place at the kitchen table. Marjorie stands across the room from him, her arms crossed as if she feels a chill. That, of course, is impossible. Nightfall has not brought any relief from the day's heat.
"I just don't understand."
She speaks so slowly, even the last word comes out as two.
"I thought when we talked about this before, we decided it wasn't a good idea."
Only now does it register on Bill that his wife has dressed herself for the holiday. She's wearing a sleeveless red bandana blouse knotted at her midriff, blue petal pushers, and white sneakers that might have been Anne's. Her dark, freshly curled hair has been combed out to frame her small, pretty, heart-shaped face. Yes, her pretty face, even when it's darkened by a frown, as it is now.
"I've reconsidered," says Bill. "I think this'll work, and to everyone's benefit."
Marjorie crosses the room, pulls out a chair, and sits down wearily across from him. She takes off her glasses and she rubs her eyes. When Bill told her of the arrangements he made for his father's visit, she said nothing. But now she's had time to worry over all the implications of her father-in-law's visit.
"You think it will work? You want to trust the care of our children to a man they barely know, who barely knows them, a man who abandoned his own children?"
Bill lights a cigarette, even though each one he's smoked in the last few hours has left a bitter, dusty taste in his mouth.
"Why is it, Marjorie, that I've been able to forgive my father and you haven't? I was the one he left." "Maybe because there are some things people shouldn't be forgiven for."
"Is that," Bill asks, "for us to decide?"
For the moment, Bill holds the advantage. Marjorie's religion teaches that it falls only to God to judge, and it's a lesson she tries to obey. In consternation, she rubs her hand across the tabletop as though there are wrinkles in the formica that could be smoothed out like a tablecloth.
"Besides, it's not just for the kids," Bill says. "I think we'd both feel more comfortable knowing a man is in the house. But he knows the business, too, and probably better than Don or Tom. After all, Dad used to be in real estate."
"But he's not in the business anymore," Marjorie quickly points out. "He's a cowboy. An old cowboy who has never shown the slightest interest in his grandchildren. Why would we leave Anne and Will in the care of a man who might walk off?"
"That happened once, under special circumstances, Marjorie. He deserves a second chance."
"A chance? Do you hear what you're saying? You want to take a chance with Anne and Will? And he's had plenty of chances, hasn't he? He didn't have to leave, but he didn't have to stay away either. He could have come back to you and Jeanette at any time."
"You know as well as I do," Bill says sternly, "what kept him away."
"Even grief has its limits.
And I'm not talking about grief alone."
"You're so quick to make excuses for him."
"Look, he's out there in the middle of the prairie in that little trailer. I'm concerned about him. It's no use telling me I shouldn't be, that I owe him nothing. I can't help it. If something happened to him, he could lie there for days, for weeks, and never be discovered. I'd like to see if I can get him to come back to town.
That remark instantly erases the weariness from Marjorie's face, and just as quickly Bill realizes he's made a mistake.
To live here? She says. No, no, because if that's what you mean, that's not what I have in mind, not at all. Just someplace a little closer, so I wouldn't have to drive for hours just to check up on him.
Is that what he wants?
Well, he said yes to coming here, so maybe he's changing his mind about some things.
Marjorie shakes her head.
This sounds like some kind of plan for redemption.
Bill smiles.
I can't think of anything that would matter less to Calvin Sidey. Redemption isn't in his vocabulary.
I didn't say he wanted it, but I certainly believe it's something you want for him.
My God, her aim could be unerring at times. Bill has no choice but to skate around her remark.
Besides, Bill says, once you spend some time with the kids.
Yes?
You don't think our kids are lovable enough to melt any heart?
Bill says, and laughs.
He adds, you could still have the operation here. You know I want that doctor Carol had, and I want to be free of this.
Bill thinks but doesn't say, yes, but Carol only had to drive across town for her operation, while you have to travel close to 400 miles for yours. As if she can hear his thoughts, Marjorie says,
Carol tried everything, and if she wouldn't have found him, she'd still be in misery.
Like I am. She doesn't have to say the words. The insinuation is clear. And no matter how skeptical Bill might be about the necessity for Marjorie's operation, much less having it in Missoula, he does not want to be the kind of husband who stands in the way of his wife's hope for good health.
I'm already on the surgery schedule, says Marjorie, her voice trembling and her eyes brimming with tears.
Bill reaches across the table to lay his hand on top of his wife's. Her flesh is surprisingly cool. We'll stay with the original plan. And just as quickly, the advantage is back to Marjorie.
Your father wasn't part of the original plan. You know I was never real comfortable with the idea of leaving the kids alone. I know Anne's not the sort to be throwing wild parties, but putting her in charge would mean giving her a lot of responsibility. Think of what you were like at that age.
He immediately wishes he could take his words back. Marjorie hates being reminded how at 16, her father and mother sent her to live for the summer with an elderly aunt in Billings. The old woman had been ill, and Marjorie was supposed to help with the cooking and cleaning. Anyway, that was the reason Mr. and Mrs. Randolph gave to family and friends for sending their daughter away. Although the truth was they were desperate to break up Marjorie's relationship with that 20-year-old cowboy. They had tried forbidding their daughter to see him. He was too old for her, too wild, and the two of them were too serious. But Marjorie and Tully could not be kept apart. The Randolphs hoped that Miles would accomplish what all their prohibitions, all their punishments, and all their pleas could not. But Tully had followed Marjorie to Billings, and by the time he moved on, or was chased off by Marjorie's aunt, he and Marjorie had decided that they would never return to Gladstone. At the end of August, once Tully could collect a good portion of his summer wages, he would come for Marjorie, and together they would leave Billings for a destination where they could make their own new life. Young people always make such promises and plans, but maybe that one would have worked out had Tully not gone back to a job that required him to fix a stretch of fence during a thunderstorm.
You would have thought that a nearby stand of lodgepole pines presented an easier target for that lightning bolt.
When Marjorie returned to high school that fall, like everyone else, Bill noticed the change in her. She was no longer that bright-eyed, laughing, lovely girl who used to dash out of the building in winter months with her coat unbuttoned because she couldn't wait to meet her boyfriend. Instead, she trudged listlessly through the halls and through her classes as if she had been awakened from a drugged sleep. Rumors about the altered Marjorie Randolph raced around Gladstone. One version had her running off to Billings the previous summer to have Tully Heckerman's baby, which she then gave up for adoption. Another whispered story said that she tried to poison herself after Tully's death. Then about the time of graduation, Bill saw another change come over her. Suddenly it seemed as though Marjorie was trying to make Tully's untamed spirit her own. She drank. She smoked. She went out with men and boys who were willing to tell their friends what Marjorie Randolph would let them get away with. When Bill finally stirred up the courage to ask Marjorie to go out with him, and later to marry him, he believed she said yes not only because he offered her security, but also because he understood a thing or two about loss and abandonment. But if Bill's remark takes Marjorie back to her own past, she doesn't acknowledge it. Coolly, she says, Beverly is right next door. It's not exactly like the kids would be without adult supervision.
And she'll still be here, Bill replies. I'll tell her about Dad staying at the house and ask her if she'll keep an eye on him and the kids.
Marjorie puts her glasses back on and looks squarely at her husband.
Suppose he starts drinking again?
It's not going to happen, honey. Not after all this time. He hasn't had a drink in over 10 years.
That you know of.
Rather than concede that point, as he must, Bill says nothing. Up and down the block, firecrackers still snap, singly or serially, and bottle rockets still hiss. But more and more time passes between these small explosions. Soon Gladstone will finish its celebrating, and once again it will be heat and not noise that stands between the townspeople and their easy sleep. Marjorie looks off expectantly, as though she's counting off the minutes between detonations.
They could come with us, Bill suggests cautiously, and I could tell Dad he isn't needed.
Marjorie shakes her head.
It would be too hard for them. They couldn't come to the hospital.
Anne's old enough.
But they never let her take off work for God knows how many days. She'd come back and find she's out of a job. And Penny's is just too good an opportunity. This is something she can keep working at right through the school year.
Bill holds his hands up in surrender.
You're right, I know. We talked about that.
Marjorie sniffs as if the odor of black powder has drifted into her kitchen.
He'll be here Saturday?
Right. Saturday afternoon or evening.
Maybe I'll fix fried chicken. That's something we can have cold if he doesn't get here until late.
Fried chicken sounds good.
Maybe, says Marjorie, a ham for Sunday. Which they could have for leftovers on Monday.
Marjorie nods, as if settling on those menu items has resolved every difference between them.
Well, I'm going up, she says. When you come, leave the stove light on for Anne.
Then Marjorie stands up, walks around to Bill, and kisses him lightly on the lips. But she doesn't leave the room.
I guess I still don't understand, she says, why he agreed to come.
Give him some credit, Marjorie. He's an old man. He might want to make amends. Not that Bill believes this for a moment.
Chapter 4. Anne Sidey does not look back when she turns the corner and starts to walk up 4th Street. She doesn't have to. She hears the car make the same turn, lugging along in second gear, its headlights off. She knows it's following her, yet so far not trying to overtake her. The car radio is playing, Leslie Gore singing It's My Party, so Anne decides to concentrate on the song. She'll walk faster only if the radio gets louder, and she won't break into a run unless the car pulls to the curb alongside her. Then she'll take off across the lawns. The Halls live halfway up the block, and if she can make it to their house, she'll bang on their door until they let her in.
Cry if I want to. Cry if I want to.
The car is a black 1952 Ford Tudor, and Anne is familiar with many of the ways its owner has customized the car. He has done things to the engine she doesn't entirely understand, things with valves and carburetors and plugs and points. And he's changed the exhaust system so it growls a warning even when the car is standing still. He moved the gear shift from the steering column to the floor, and on top of the shifter is an oval of wood crudely carved to look like the head of a ferocious Indian warrior. The seat covers are rough wool and can scratch the backs of your bare arms and legs.
and the knob on the window crank and the door handle can gouge into your back if you're pushed up against the passenger door. Anne knows that if you push the first button on the radio, the station will jump to Miles City. The second will bring in Billings, the third Dickinson, North Dakota, and the fourth and best KOMA in Oklahoma City. Anne knows the sound the cigarette lighter makes when it pops out, and she knows the look of it close up as it glows red-orange. The sidewalk climbs and curves, and Anne moves to the edge of the cement, almost stepping into the weeds of the vacant lot. Here, without a house staring down at her, Anne has to be ready to run. The air feels slightly cooler as she walks past the open field, and the sound of the car's engine throbs all the way over to the next block. But she passes safely, and the next house not only has its porch light on, but its curtains open as well. Off to her left, a Roman candle fizzles into flight. Did it come from McDonough's backyard? It must have been a dud because it didn't attain any height, but instead sparked and spiraled erratically into the lower branches of a curbside tree. That sudden flare is enough to distract Anne and prevent her from noticing the cherry bomb that rolls into the gutter only a few paces behind her. By the time she registers the hiss of the fuse, the detonation is only a half second away. She has walked unperturbed through a day of explosions, but this blam! The sound she feels in her chest frightens a shriek from her, and she starts to run as if a shell from an enemy's artillery has burst at her feet. Between two houses she runs, and when she's away from the streetlights and into the backyards, she can no longer see where her feet will fall, but she does not slow. In the hour past midnight, dew has begun to form, and she slips and sinks on the wet turf. She crosses into another yard, and when she does, she alerts a dog back by the alley, a big dog by the sound of its bark. Its chain rattles and snaps taut, and Anne veers in another direction. She needs to stay away from the alley anyway in case he circles around and drives behind the houses. What trips her, she isn't sure. A croquet hoop, a sprinkler, a wire fence around a flower bed. But she goes sprawling and skids forward on her hands and knees. The odor of wet grass fills her nostrils, and for a moment she's tempted just to lie still and hope she won't be seen. But her white slacks will probably glow against the black-green lawn, and she'd rather be chased down than to have him come up behind her, grab her ankles, and drag her off to God knows where. When Anne rises and begins to run again, she takes it a bit slower and lifts her feet higher. And soon she comes to the end of the block and a familiar sight— the white shed of the Reinbohm's backyard. And she's sure of the landmark because before Mr. Reinbohm began to store his garden tools in there, that little building had been Mary Reinbohm's playhouse. And all through grade school, Anne, Mary, Karen Kemper, and Judy Falk used it for their clubhouse. Then, in the summer before seventh grade, Mary drowned in the Elk River. In the following year, Mr. Reinbohm moved out the toys and the play dishes and old dresses and moved in his shovels, rakes, hoe, and mower. Anne has not been inside since Mary was alive, but she's sure she can still work the latch on the bottom half of the double door. And if she crawls inside, she can probably make her way to the back wall and find the spot where she, Mary, Karen, and Judy wrote their initials in purple crayon. But she doesn't have to hide. Not yet, not now. The sense of being pursued is gradually leaving her, and if she stands still for just another minute or two, she might be ready to step back into the light. She's only a block from home, close enough to feel not only that safety is reachable, but also to feel a little power flowing back in her direction. 17 years of living in this rectangle of rectangles, the right-angle geometry of intersections and streets, of sidewalks and alleys, of lawns and houses, now counts for something. Sometimes she can feel her heart quicken with fear when she thinks about her little town's isolation. How frail and temporary it seems in comparison to the hundreds, thousands of miles of shapeless prairie that surround Gladstone. How comforting it must be, she thinks at those times, to live in a huge city, block after block of sheltering bricks and boards. But right now she's close enough to being inside that she dares to step out into the open. Through the space between the Reinbohms and the Winters, Anne walks calmly. But when she reaches the sidewalk, even though there's no sign of the car or its driver, she breaks into a run again.
and she does not slow until she turns into her own driveway. The light is on over the side door, and she stands in that circle of luminescence and waits for her heart rate to return to normal. If her parents are still up, she doesn't want to have to answer their questions about why she's breathing so hard. Overhead, moths and insects whir, flutter, and crawl around the porch light, and Anne retreats into the darkness to get away from them, especially the thick-bodied, clicking June bugs. She steps back into a sulfurous smell, and it takes her a moment to locate its source. Her little brother Will has been lighting snakes in the driveway again, those long tubes of black ash that writhe mysteriously forth from a tiny pill when set aflame. The odor is not merely unpleasant, but disgusting. It reminds her of farts. And her mother hates the black smudges the snakes leave on the concrete. Poor Will. While his friends have moved on to firecrackers and bottle rockets, he's still lighting snakes and waving sparklers. Anne does exactly as her mother taught her, filling the washtub first, then pouring in a cup of oxidol and a half cup of bleach, the smell of which stings her nostrils. She takes off her slacks and drops them into the water. As they slowly sink, they seem to turn gray, and Anne knows the stain won't come out. Maybe she can cut them off and make shorts out of them. She looks down at her bare legs. She's been working 35 to 40 hours a week in the boys' department at Penny's, so she doesn't have many opportunities to get out in the sun. Nevertheless, she still has a tan line. Two, in fact, one in the middle of her thigh from her shorts, and another, much higher, from the fewer occasions when she's been out in her bathing suit down at the river. That was where he and his friends were drinking beer and eating fried chicken when Anne and Kitty walked by. "I'd like to take a bite out of those thighs," he'd said. Anne knew he was talking about her, because he was looking right at her, and then he tossed a chicken bone that landed in the sand at her feet. That was before she started at Penny's, when she could spend as much time down at the river as she liked. Maybe she should have gotten angry at his remark, but she knew who Monty Hyatt was and what her friends had been saying about him. He came from Laramie, and he moved to Gladstone because his parents split up, and his mother's cousin lived here, and he gave Mrs. Hyatt a job in his furniture store. The new boy was going to be a junior, but right from the start he hung out with the seniors, especially the car guys. Was Monty Hyatt a hood? She couldn't say for sure. That hair, and he smoked. He had his own car, and from what the other boy said, it was impressive. But Anne understood little about cars or the worship of them. What she did understand was what the girls meant when they talked about him. Monty Hyatt was cute, and according to Lori Dwyer, who lived on his block, he was nice. Cute and nice. There were not two other words in the English language that could be applied to a new boy from Laramie that would make him more appealing. And hers were the thighs he wanted to take a bite from. Anne had laughed over his comment. Not in front of him, of course. But she and Kitty both burst out laughing as soon as they had walked far enough along the sand that the boys couldn't hear them. Take a bite. It was exactly the kind of stupid thing a boy might think was clever or flirty or even romantic. She doesn't know how it could have happened without tearing her slacks, but one of her knees is scraped raw. The first layer of skin has peeled back, exposing a wet pink layer. A few years ago, a neighbor cut his hand with a power saw, and her father had taken him to the hospital. "I was surprised," her father said. "There wasn't much blood, but that blade cut right through the meat to the bone." Meat. Is that what's pinkly showing under the scraped away first layer of skin? Is that what he wanted to bite his way down to? Anne knew he wanted to put his hands on her, in her. But maybe it was more. Maybe it was worse. He wanted to rip her apart, to explode her into pieces. Isn't that what he was doing when he tossed that firecracker in her direction? Oh, she has to stop. She's going too far, just being melodramatic, as her mother says Anne can be. Footsteps thump down the basement stairs, and Anne grabs a towel from the laundry basket and wraps it around her waist. Her father thrusts his head around the corner and peers into the laundry room. "Hey, sunshine," he says.
Kind of late to be washing clothes, isn't it? I got a grass stain on my new pants. I thought I'd better soak them before it sets. He asks, enjoy the fireworks? I guess. Anne doubts that her father has come down here to make small talk. In an attempt to hurry him to his real reason for being here, she stages an elaborate yawn that turns into the real thing. Her father takes his cue. Do you have to work tomorrow? Not until noon, but I told Kitty I'd come over to her house early and help her paint her room.
Smart. Do that work before the day heats up.
He clears his throat and pats his shirt pocket for the pack of cigarettes that isn't there.
Look, he says, there's been a slight change of plans. Your mom and I are still going to Missoula as scheduled, but instead of you and Will being by yourselves, I've asked your grandfather to come and stay with you. Now, before you say a word, this isn't for you. God knows you're old enough to stay alone. But Will needs somebody close by, and with you at work so much of the time. And besides, it's not fair to ask you to give up your summer freedom to care for your little brother.
Her summer freedom? It's all Anne can do not to laugh out loud. She can't walk through her own neighborhood without looking worriedly over her shoulder. She says, I don't mind.
I know you never said a word of complaint, but I just think this is a better arrangement. And again, it's for your brother. It's not because we don't trust you or think you can't handle things. You understand that, don't you?
Okay, sure.
It's her father who doesn't understand. Anne isn't angry or offended that their grandfather is coming to stay with her, and will. She's nervous. Wouldn't anyone be if a stranger was coming to live within your walls? For that's what her grandfather is to Anne. He lives alone out on the prairie in his little trailer, and he almost never comes to Gladstone, even though the town was once his home. Anne can't even be sure when she last saw him. 4 years ago? 5? He came to Gladstone to attend a funeral, and before he drove back to his trailer, he stopped at the Sidey home for supper. She remembers a tall, white-haired man in a black suit striding up their front walk. A man who looked so stern as he approached the house that Anne wondered if the family was in some kind of trouble. Oh, it has to be at least 5 years. And when her father introduced her, he said, you remember Grandpa Sidey, don't you? And though Anne nodded yes, she couldn't be sure. And now that man will be staying in their house. And what will she say to him? Now it's Anne's father's turn to yawn.
You won't spend the whole night down here, will you?
I'm just going to soak my pants a little while longer.
Okay. Good night, sweetheart.
He's almost out of the laundry room when Anne calls her father back.
Dad? Her father turns to her with such an innocently expectant look, she immediately realizes she can't say what's on her mind. That's the face of a father who wants to hear his daughter say that she's glad he's home, or that she doesn't think this year's fireworks were as good as last year's. How can she say to that face, Daddy, someone's after me. He wants to blow me up, rip me apart, eat me alive.
What is it, honey?
It's been so long since Grandpa lived in town. Does he even know how to do it?
He's out of practice, that's for sure. So he'll probably need some help. You'll get him over the rough parts, won't you? She nods. And you'll be patient with him?
He laughs when he says this, and while she isn't sure if he's serious, she nods at this too.
But isn't that the kind of remark that her father should have been making to her grandfather about his grandchildren?
Okay, good night again.
He starts to leave, and though Anne does not call him back, he returns to the laundry room.
He knows, she thinks. I don't have to find the words. He knows.
You didn't happen to take a beer from the refrigerator, did you?
I didn't, Anne says.
Of course you didn't. And I'm not going to wake your brother to ask him. He laughs again, as though that's the punchline to a joke everyone knows.
Chapter 5. In the alley behind his home, Will Sidey smooths a circle in the dirt. The sun has not yet reached mid-morning height, but the pebbles he picks out of his circle are warm to the touch. He puts a firecracker,
nothing more powerful than a lady finger, into the center of the circle, and then places an empty, upside-down butternut coffee can over the firecracker, making sure to leave as much of the fuse as possible sticking out from the can's rim. Will touches the fuse with the smoldering punk he stuck into the dirt and then scurries back a good 10 feet. There's a quick sizzling sound like spit, but no explosion. The can must have pinched off the fuse. Will is about to step forward to investigate when a voice stops him.
Jesus! You think you're far enough away?
Coming down the alley are three boys close to Will in age. Like Will, they all wear sneakers, jeans, and t-shirts. For reasons none of them can recall, they've decided to favor the Cincinnati Reds this year, so they've cut off the sleeves of their t-shirts in imitation of the uniform of their favorite team. Only Stuart Kinder, the tallest of the three, wears a Reds cap. The other two wear caps with ironed-on bees, because Boyd Insurance sponsors their Little League team. Will is bareheaded, though he also plays for the Boyd Bulldogs. Will has just turned away from his coffee can circle and is walking toward his friends when there's a tiny pinging explosion behind him. He jumps, and Stuart points at him and laughs.
What the hell was that? A ladyfinger?
One of those fuckers went off in my hand last year. He wiggles the fingers of his right hand.
You don't see nothing missing, do you?
The coffee can still stands bottom up in the middle of the circle, but Will only stares at it. He jams his hands into the pockets of his jeans in case the trembling in his hands is visible. If his friends hadn't appeared at that moment, Will would have lifted the can to investigate why his firecracker hadn't gone off. He doesn't care what Stuart said. Will is sure that firecrackers, even ladyfingers, can do real damage. What if he would have put his face down there because he thought the firecracker was a dud? He could have lost an eye.
You should light the whole pack under there, Bobby Mueller says. I bet that can would jump around like it was dancing.
I blew a chunk out of a soup can with a silver salute, says Glenn Spees.
Where'd you get a silver salute? Asks Stuart.
My cousin goes up to Canada every summer. He brings back a whole shitload of stuff you can't get here.
Let me know the next time he goes. I'll put in my own order.
Will finally lifts his butternut can, but slowly, as if he fears another explosive might still be under there, its fuse burning at its own willed speed.
Hey, Will, Bobby says, you still got that can of beer?
Under the can is nothing but paper, shredded into scraps tinier than any hand could tear.
It's hidden in my closet, Will says. So it ain't cold, Glenn says.
No, my closet is refrigerated, shit for brains.
My old man says drinking warm beer is like drinking piss.
He'd know, I guess. Fuck you!
Stuart loops a finger through a belt loop of Will's jeans and tugs him to his feet.
It don't matter. Go get it. We can stick it in the river. It'll get cold in no time.
The river? I thought we were going to play ball.
We ain't got enough guys, Bobby says. Not even.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.